If you're interested in spirituality, I strongly recommend the writings of William Johnston, the late Father William Johnston. He was a well-known authority on mysticism. He was an Irish Jesuit priest who lived in Japan much of his life. He was a professor of religious studies at Sophia University in Tokyo. For many years, Johnston had been involved in the Christian Buddhist dialogue, which believers from these different paths were quietly coming together to talk and to meditate, to give witness to a world that longs for peace. I mean, William Johnston is one of many Christians who have been challenged in their encounter with the Eastern religious traditions, were challenged to enter more deeply into their own mystical way. In Johnston's book, The Inner Eye of Love, which was published in 1981, he says that mysticism is the wisdom that goes beyond words and letters, beyond reasoning and thinking, beyond imaging and fantasy, beyond, before and after, into the timeless reality. Well, some things don't change, namely the importance of love. In Christianity, Johnston says, mysticism begins and ends with the experience of being loved. We loved because God first loves us. In 1991, Johnston published a book called Letters to Contemplatives. And here he underlines the importance of relationships. They must be given a central place in a renewed mysticism. So he gives attention to things like human intimacy, the place of interpersonal relationships, and the links with mysticism and social justice, the role of mysticism in the secular activity of people and marriage and sexuality, and the social problems that plague contemporary society. Johnston, authentic religion must belong to the world that it serves. Well, today, we're not looking so much for organised religion, but for mysticism. That's something that's become very important. And it's partly because, as Johnston points out, the culture of Asia, which is fast spreading to the whole world, is just very mystical. And there are indications, he says, that the Western world is also searching for mysticism. And he goes on to make this really prophetic claim that a new mysticism is emerging within Christianity. So today, he says, another school of mysticism is coming to birth, thanks to this ongoing dialogue with Buddhism, Taoism, and Hinduism. And so Johnston is calling us to find our contemplative roots. He appeals to us to read the signs of the times and then to enter into dialogue. Things we should learn from the last century, the 20th century, was that it was a century of dialogue. And that was what the Second Vatican Council was all about. You know, God's grace is at work in all human hearts. Johnston recognised that something was happening, something was developing in the world of mysticism as East and West through a dialogue that was based on experience. That the Eastern and the Western approaches can complement and help each other. And so Johnston paves the way for a dialogue based not on dogmas and doctrines, but on religious experience. Although in the still point, Johnston expressed doubt about whether a Christian Zen can exist. In his next book, Christian Zen, published in 1971, he now feels he was mistaken. Changed his mind. In Christian Zen, Johnston talks about how Zen and Christianity have met in his thought. But he clearly differentiates between Zen Buddhism and Zen itself. Now the word Zen refers to objectless meditation. So it can be used in conjunction with any of the great religions. Johnston thinks that Christianity can learn from Zen some techniques and an approach to life that will help it to be more Christian. And so he introduces Zen for rediscovering Christian contemplation. And the assurance that it is something that's inherent in the Christian tradition. He doesn't hesitate to say that his own faith has been deepened through Zen. Other ways of achieving a consciousness of the indwelling Holy Spirit. But Johnston recommends the Zen way of breathing, deep down to the centre of being, where in mystical silence the sense of one's being can be lost in a sense of the being of God. The thing in Zen is detachment, not simply from physical things, cravings, but from all the images and ideas and concepts that are so dear to Western men and women. Words can take away the real vision. There's a danger of adoring images and concepts of God instead of God himself. And Johnston says that Christ can be known without ideas, that he can be known in the darkness, in the void, in the emptiness that transcends thought. That's to say, the deepest, most interior presence is God, not oneself. As Christians, that the words and the images and the concepts of Christ are not Christ. The living and the risen Christ is the unknowable Christ. He's coextensive with the universe and buried in the hollow recesses of the human heart. First thing that interested me about Johnston's writings was that he seemed to address the scientific outlook of modern people, and the findings of psychology, and also the thirst for inwardness. This was especially evident in the first book that I read by William Johnston, which was Silent Music, which was published in 1974. Johnston was struggling to demonstrate how spirituality and science can work together. Johnston accepts the difference between techniques and grace. Johnston emphasises the difference between experimentation, which measures and induces altered states of consciousness, and the ecstatic love affair, in which, in the words of St. John of the Cross, the beloved is the mountains, the solitary wooded valleys, strange islands, silent music. Movement, Johnston puts the meditator mystic, the builder of the future, because he loves. And it's this energy of love that will bring about the harmony of silent music in a discordant world. So in this context then, Christians share a quest for wisdom with Buddhists and scientists. As Johnston says, we cannot survive unless we unite to build the earth and mould the human family into a single community. It's all about mysticism, meditation, but also dialogue. Mysticism and dialogue have to go together. We see this between the East and the West, in Christianity and Buddhism, between Christianity and science. It's all about dialogue. The struggle to live an authentic Christian spirituality can learn from the way in which other human beings seek to be authentic. And it's this struggle also requires an ongoing conversion. There's to be a renewal of Christian mysticism and a dialogue motivated by love, in which people are ready to embrace all that is good, true, and authentically human, wherever they find it.